Problem 16. First, let us read the statement of the problem. The problem says, an ordinary differential equation may sometimes have an additional solution that cannot be obtained from the general solution and is then called a singular solution. The ODE y dash square minus x y dash plus y equal to 0 is of this kind. Show by differentiation and substitution that it has the general solution y equal to cx minus c square and the singular solution y equal to x square by 4. Now, in the problem, it has been given that the general solution is y equal to cx minus c square. Now, in the general solution, if we substitute a value of c, then we get a particular solution. However, if we cannot obtain a solution of a differential equation from the general solution by substituting any value of c, then that kind of solution is called a singular solution. Here, the singular solution that has been proposed in the problem is y equal to x square divided by 4. Now, we can clearly see that in the general solution, the maximum exponent of x is 1. However, in the singular solution, the exponent is 2. So, there is no way that we can obtain the general solution from the singular solution. We will substitute the general solution and the singular solution into the ordinary differential equation to check that they are actually the solution of the ordinary differential equation. For the general solution, we will calculate first derivative of y with respect to x, which will be c, and for the singular solution, we will calculate first derivative of y, which will be x divided by 2. Now we substitute and we get y dash square, which is c square minus x multiplied by y prime, which is c, plus y. Y in general solution is c x minus c square. In this, we can cancel these two terms and also these two terms and get the result 0. So, the equation satisfies. So, we know that y equal to cx minus c square is a solution of ODE given in the problem. For the singular solution, similarly we proceed. We x by 2 whole square minus x multiplied by x divided by 2 plus y, which is x square by 4 for the singular solution. We simplify it and get x square divided by 4 minus x square divided by 2 plus x square divided by 4. So, this gets x square divided by 2 minus x square divided by 4, sorry, x square divided by 2, which is equal to 0. So, equation satisfies. Thus, we know that y equal to x square divided by 4 is also a solution of the ODE. The second part of a problem is to explain figure 6. Now, in the figure, various lines have been drawn. These lines represent the general solution of the differential equation. We see that the general solution is of the form y equal to mx plus c, which is a straight line. So, these all are the general solution of the differential equation for various values of c. For various values of c, we get all these straight lines. We have also learned that the singular solution y equal to x square by 4 is of a parabola. Here we can see that this is a parabola. y equal to x square by 4 is a parabola which passes through the origin 0, 0. Now we will try to explain the figure. First we will graph the solutions, both the general and the singular solution in Sage Math. Then we will proceed to explain. We will plot both the general solution and the singular solution using Sage Math. First we will try to plot the general solution. Now the general solution has the form y equal to cx minus c square. If we take a certain value of c, then we can easily plot the general solution. There are two options to plot the general solution. We can take multiple values of c and plot them individually, or we can use a for loop to plot the family of the straight lines. Now Sage Math uses similar syntax to Python, so we will use a for loop for c in range minus 10 to 10 comma 1. Now what this does is the value of c gets selected from minus 10 and gets incremented by 1 till it reaches 10, and in each iteration of the loop the value of c selected gets used in the logic that is written inside the loop. So now we will take a variable p and assign it to plot of the general solution, which is c multiplied by x minus c square, x range minus 10 to 10 . Now if we try to plot the value of p after the loop, then it will only show the last iteration of the value of p, but we want to show all the values of p for all iterations, for all values of c. So what we have to do is we have to take a placeholder variable q, and we have to initialize the value of q before the loop. Q equal to plot of 0. Now this plot of 0 is a dummy plot. We have assigned it to q, and now we assign q equal to previous value of q plus the value of p. Now what q does is it takes the value of p for the specific value of c that is being used in that iteration, and it assigns to q. In the next iteration, the value of q is added with a new value of p for that iteration. Thus q now holds all the plots for all values of c. Now we will try to plot q. For that we use the syntax q dot show. Now evaluate. Now this shows the family of straight lines for values of c from minus 10 to 10 with increment of 1. Now we will try to plot the singular solution. For that we will take another variable s, and we will assign it to plot x to the power 2 divided by 4. We will try to plot this from same x range minus 10 to 10. Now we want this plot to have a separate color, so we will use color equal to in quotation marks red, and we also want this to have a different thickness because we know that this will be tangential to this line, and since these lines have a default thickness, if we use that default thickness then it might not show. So we will use a higher thickness. We use thickness equal to let's say 3. Now what we will do is we will take this q which holds the family of straight lines, and we will take this s which holds the singular solution, and assign it to another variable r which is equal to q plus s. Why we are adding is if we plot these separately then these will be plotted in two separate graphs, but we want both of them to be plotted in a single graph. So what we do is add the variable q with the variable s, the variable q holding the family of straight lines and the variable s holding the parabola. Now we place put r dot show and we delete this q dot show because we don't want this to be printed twice. Now we evaluate. This is showing some error. The spelling of color is wrong, so we have to write COLOR. Now we evaluate. Now this is the red line is the parabola and the blue lines are the family of straight lines which are tangential to the parabola. Now we will explain why the singular solution is also a solution to the ordinary differential equation. In the problem, it is given that the general solution is y equal to cx minus c square and the singular solution is y equal to x square by 4. First, we will find out the equation of tangent at any point x0, y0 on the parabola. Suppose the point x0, y0 is here on the parabola. We will find out the equation of the straight line that is tangential to the parabola at x0, y0. At x0 comma y0. The general equation of a straight line passing through x0 comma y0 is y minus y0 is equal to the slope of the straight line x minus x0. First we have to find out m. Now m can be found out by differentiating the function y equal to x square by 4, because we want to find out the equation of the straight line at a point x0 comma y0 which is situated on the parabola. So we find out the slope y dash which is x by 2. The slope at the point x0 comma y0 will be slope equal to x0 divided by 2. We place this in this equation to find out the equation of the tangent, which will be y minus y0 is equal to x0 by 2 x minus x0. The right side we can solve and we get x0 by 2 x minus x0 square divided by 2. Now in the left side we have y0, and from this equation, from the equation of the parabola, we know that y equal to x square by 4. So at point x0 and y0 we can write y0 equal to x0 square divided by 4 as the point is situated on the parabola. So we can rewrite this equation as y minus x0 square divided by 4 equal to x0 x divided by 2 minus x0 square divided by 2, which we can simplify to y equal to, we take this minus x0 square by 4 to the right side and we write x0 divided by 2 multiplied by x minus x0 square divided by 4. Now if we take c equal to x0 divided by 2, then we can write this equation as y equal to cx minus c square, which we see that this is the original general solution of the differential equation for c equal to x0 by 2. if we take c equal to x0 by 2, then the tangent to the singular solution is the general solution of the differential equation. So we see for any point x0, y0 on the parabola, the tangent to that parabola is the same as the general solution if we consider c equal to x0 by 2. Now we have c equal to x0 by 2 at any point x0 comma y0 on the parabola. So at any point x0, y0 on the parabola, the slope will be x0 divided by 2 if we calculate it from the singular solution, and if we calculate it from the general solution, the slope will be y dash equal to c, which is also x0 by 2 from this. So we see at any point x0, y0 on the parabola, the slope when calculated from the general solution is the same as the slope when calculated from the singular solution. Also, it is obvious that the value of x and the value of y at that point will be same for the general solution and the singular solution, both will be x0 and y0. So since at any point x0, y0, the value of slope and the value of x and the value of y are same, so if the general solution satisfies this equation y dash square minus x y dash plus y equal to 0, then the singular solution must also satisfy, because at any point x 0 comma y 0, the value of y dash, x, y dash and y are the same. To solve an engineering problem or actually physical problem, we have to formulate the problem as a mathematical expression in terms of variables, functions and equations. Such an expression is known as a mathematical model of the given problem. The process of setting up a model, solving it mathematically, then interpreting the result in physical and other terms is called mathematical modeling or briefly modeling. In problems 17 to 20, we are going to form mathematical models from given physical problems, then we are going to solve the models, and then we are going to interpret the problems. This flowchart is given in the book to explain this. First, a physical system is given, then we interpret it and make it into a mathematical model. After that, we solve the model, then we interpret the solution physically. Problem 17. The statement of the problem is, the half-life measures exponential decay. It is the time in which half of the given amount of radioactive substance will disappear. What is the half-life of radium-226 in years in example 5? So to do this problem, we have to first understand what was in example 5. Example 5 is regarding exponential decay. So in this, first we will read this physical information that is given. It is given that experiments show that at each instant a radioactive substance decomposes and is thus decaying in time proportional to the amount of substance present. That means if we consider y of t as the amount of substance that is present in a given sample, then the rate of decay dy by dt will be proportional to y, that is the amount of substance still remaining in the sample. We can write this as dy by dt equal to minus k y. As the substance is decreasing, by radioactive decay, so the amount of Y in the sample is decreasing with time. That is why we have taken this negative symbol here. Now the problem is given that for radium 226 the value of K is 1.4 into 10 to the power minus 11 second inverse. In the initial problem it was given that at the starting the amount of radioactive substance present was 0.5 gram. That means at T equal to 0, Y equal to 0.5 gram. That is Y of 0 is equal to 0.5 gram. Now first we have established the differential equation, then we have got the initial value condition. Now it is a initial value problem. Now we will solve this dy by dt equal to minus ky, which implies dy by y equal to minus k dt. Integrate both sides, we get y of t equal to c e to the power minus kt. We have done a similar problem in problem number 3 of this problem set 1.1. Now in this equation if we put t is equal to 0, we get y of t equal to c e to the power 0, which is equal to c. So we see that value of c is equal to y of 0, or c is the amount of substance present at time is equal to 0. We can write this as, we can write this equation again as y of t is equal to c e to the power minus kt. In place of c we write y of 0 e to the power minus kt. Now we have to remember this equation, that is amount of substance at any time t is equal to amount of substance at time t equal to 0 multiplied by e to the power minus k. K is a constant, the value of which is given here. For radium 226 it is 1.4 into 10 to the power minus 11 second inverse multiplied by the time t. For this problem it has been given that the time, at time 0 the amount of substance was 0.5, so that is why the equation becomes y t is equal to 0.5, that is y 0 multiplied by e to the power minus k t. This is interpreted in the graph. In the graph we can see that at time t is equal to 0 the amount of substance was 0.5, and as time increases it follows the graph e to the power minus kt, and at time t tends to infinity y of t tends to 0. Now we will solve the problem 17. We have got the equation y of t, that is amount of radioactive substance present at time t is equal to y of 0, that is amount of radioactive substance present at time t is equal to 0 multiplied by e to the power minus k t, where k is equal to 1.4 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 11 second inverse for radium 226. In the problem it is given what is the half life of radium 226 in example 5. Half life means time taken for decay of half of the radioactive substance. That means for T to become half life, y of t will be half of initial amount of substance that was in the sample. We substitute it in the equation, we get half of y0 is equal to y0 multiplied by e to the power minus k t h. We denote t h is equal to half life. Then from left and right y0 cancels and we get half is equal to e to the power minus k t h. We take log of both sides and we get ln 0.5 is equal to minus k t h ln e, which is 1. So half life is equal to ln 0.5 divided by minus k. The value of k for radium 226 is given, so this will be ln 0.5 divided by minus 1.4 multiplied by 10 to the power 11 seconds. In order to express this in years, we will first multiply 3600 to convert it into hours, then we will multiply 24 in the denominator to convert it into days, then we will multiply 365 in the denominator to convert it into years. Now the unit will be years. Now we will calculate this using a calculator. 0.5 ln 0.5 multiplied by 10 raised to 11 divided by brackets minus 1.4 multiplied by 3600 multiplied by 24 multiplied by 365, we get 1569.9 years, or approximately 1569.9 years, or approximately 1570 years, which is the answer. Problem 18. The problem statement is radium 224 has a half life of about 3.6 days. That is, half life equal to 3.6 days. Given 1 gram, that means initial value of substance was 1 gram. Y of 0 is equal to 1 gram. How much would still be present after 1 day? Now we do have the equation from the previous problem number 17 and example number 5, that y of t is equal to y of 0 e to the power minus kt for radioactive decay. The value of k is different for different elements. Now we do not know the value of k for radium 224. First we have to calculate the value of k for radium 224 and then we will proceed to calculate how much substance will be present after 1 day. So the half life has been given, that means after 3.6 days, that is for t is equal to 3.6 days, half of initial substance will be present. Initial substance was 1 gram. So, amount of substance present after 3.6 days, y of 3.6 days will be 1 by 2 grams. So, we substitute into the equation and we get half gram, that is yt, amount of substance after 3.6 days is equal to y0, which is 1 gram, multiplied by e to the power minus k, which is unknown, into t. T we know is 3.6 days. One thing to remember here is the unit of this t. Now, if the unit of t we have taken is days, then the unit of k that will be calculated will be in days inverse. And if we take the unit of t in seconds, then the unit of k that will be calculated will be in second inverse. As we have seen in example 17, the value of k for radium 226 was 1.4 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 11 second inverse. Now, if the value of k given is in second inverse, then the value of t we have to use in seconds. So, we have to convert. Any unit you can take for k, but you have to see that the unit of time and the unit of k are in synchronization. So, here we calculate, we take log of both sides and we get ln 0.5 is equal to minus k multiplied by 3.6. So, k equal to ln 0.5 divided by 3.6 minus 3.6 in days inverse. You have to mention the unit. Now, we calculate this and we get ln divided by 3.6 is equal to minus, we have to take minus again. So, the value of k is 0.19254 days inverse. Now, the problem asks how much will be present after 1 day. So, what we want to calculate is what is the value of y t for t is equal to 1 day. We know y 0 is equal to 1 gram, which is given in the problem, multiplied by e to the power minus k, which is 0.19254 multiplied by 1 day. Now, since the unit of k was in days inverse, that is why we could put the unit of t in days. If we had calculated the value of k in second inverse, we would have to convert the unit of days to seconds by multiplying it with 24 and 3600. Now, we calculate it and we get e to the power minus 0.19254 grams, which is equal to minus 0.19254 to the power equal to 0.8249 grams. That is, if we had 1 grams, then after 1 day we will have 0.8249 grams of radium 224. Problem 19. In problem 19, a stone ball has been dropped and air resistance is negligible. It is mentioned that g, that is the acceleration due to gravity, is 9.8 meter per second square. The problem states that a stone ball has been dropped and the problem is asking to model an ordinary differential equation for y of t, that is the distance fallen as a function of time t. The problem states that the motion starts at time t is equal to 0, that is from rest, with velocity v, which is derivative of y with respect to t, and initial velocity is given 0, and it is asking us to obtain this equation, a function of y in terms of t. Now for this we have to know a little bit of basic physics, that is acceleration is equal to dv by dt, that is derivative of velocity with respect to time, and velocity is equal to tx by dt, or in this case ty by dt, where x or y are the displacement. First we will draw a representative diagram . Suppose the ball is dropped from the initial state from here. At this state, time t is equal to 0, distance travelled y is equal to 0, and velocity, initial velocity v is equal to 0. These three, v is equal to 0 has been given in the problem, y is obviously 0, and time t is equal to 0. After time t, let us assume the distance covered is y of t, which is this much, y of t, ball is here now after time t, and the velocity is v of t. Now we have the equation g is equal to dv by dt. Here the direction of gravity is this way, the direction of velocity is also this way, so that is why we take g is equal to dv by dt. Then we get dv is equal to g dt, we integrate both sides and we get v is equal to gt plus c1. Now we know at time t is equal to 0, v is equal to 0, that is the initial velocity is 0. We substitute this initial value condition into the problem and we get 0 is equal to 0 multiplied by g plus c1, thus c1 equal to 0, and this equation reduces to v is equal to gt. Now this equation gives velocity at time t of the stone ball. Now from this we can write dy by dt, v is equal to dy by dt is equal to gt, that is the derivative of displacement with respect to time is equal to gt, which implies dy equal to gt dt. We integrate both sides and we get y of t, or y is equal to gt square by 2 plus c2. From here we have at time t is equal to 0, y is 0. We substitute this in the equation and we get 0 equal to g 0 square by 2 plus c2, that implies c2 equal to 0. We substitute this in this equation and we get y of t is equal to g t square by 2. We get this equation. Problem 20. In the problem it is given that the efficiency of engine subsonic airplanes depends on air pressure and is maximum near 35,000 feet. Find the air pressure yx at this height. So the problem is asking us to find air pressure y of x, is air pressure at height x. The problem is asking us to find y of x at x equal to 36,000 feet. Now we can draw a diagram . We see if this is the earth surface where x equal to 0, as x increases the air pressure y of x decreases. In the problem it is given the rate of change of air pressure y dash x is proportional to the pressure. So we have y dash is proportional to y, which implies dy by dx is proportional to y, which implies dy by dx equal to minus k y. We are using this minus symbol because with increase in x the value of y or air pressure is decreasing. So the value of dy by dx, that is the rate of change of air pressure, is negative. Here k is greater than 0. We can solve this ordinary differential equation by taking all the y terms to the left side and taking all the x terms to the right side. So we have dy by y equal to minus k dx. We integrate both sides and we get ln y equal to minus k x plus c1, which implies y equal to c e to the power minus kx. We have already solved this type of ordinary differential equation in previous problems. Now it has been given in the problem that at sea level, that is at x is equal to 0, y of 0 is y naught, that is y naught is the air pressure at sea level. From this equation, if we substitute the initial value conditions, we get y naught equal to c e to the power minus k multiplied by 0. That means c equal to y naught. We place this value of c in this solution and we get y equal to y naught e to the power minus kx. That is, the air pressure y at any height x is y naught e to the power minus kx. Now in the problem it is given at 18,000 feet it is half its value at sea level. That means at x equal to 18,000, y equal to y naught by 2. We put this in this equation and we get y naught by 2 equal to y naught e to the power minus k multiplied by x, which is 18,000. Now from this equation y naught cancels out and we can find the value of k from this equation, 0.5 equal to e to the power minus k multiplied by 18,000, which implies k equal to ln 0.5 minus ln 0.5 divided by 18,000. Now the unit of k will be in fit inverse. This we can calculate using sage math. Minus ln 0.5 divided by 18,000. We get 3.85 into 10 raised to minus 5. So this comes to 10 raised to minus 5 feet inverse. Now the problem is asking us to find air pressure yx at 35,000 feet. So we use this equation to find y equal to y naught e to the power minus k multiplied by 35,000, which is equal to y naught e to the power minus 3.85 into 10 raised to minus 5 multiplied by 35,000, which is equal to y naught multiplied by, now this thing we are going to calculate using sage math, e to the power minus 3.85 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 5 multiplied by 35,000. Which is 0.2598. Now this is approximately equal to 1/4. So this approximates to y naught divided by 4. So the air pressure at 35,000 feet is approximately equal to y naught divided by 4. Now the second part of the problem is saying, can you see without calculation that the answer should be close to y naught by 4. Now in the problem, the initial value it is given at x equal to 0, y equal to y naught, and at x equal to 18,000. The air pressure reduces to half of its value at x equal to 0, and at x equal to 35,000, which is approximately 2 times of 18,000, if we assume linearity, then the air pressure should reduce to approximately half of its value, that is y naught by 4.